string theory is a peculiar theory in which the constant, in which the behavior of space-time and so forth is not an input. It's an output of some equations, and those equations have many, many solutions. The meaning of that is that there are many possibilities within string theory for the coupling constants, for the masses, even for the particle spectrum itself, for the cosmological constant, for all the parameters of the theory. It's not a single theory of the universe in which the parameters all are necessarily fixed by the equations. Not at all. Instead, it's a theory that has many, many solutions to its equations, and those solutions, each one of which has a particle spectrum, it has a collection of coupling constants, and so forth. Again, I'm speaking about the precise version of the theory, string theory with a capital S. If we ever learn a theory which is an expanded version, it's very likely that that expanded version will have even more possibilities. How many possibilities? 10 to the, people always quote 10 to the 500 different possibilities. It's much more than that. And looking for the right version of the theory is very much looking for a needle in the haystack. That collection of theories, that collection of solutions of the theory is called the landscape. It's called the landscape by me, and it's just the collection of all possible solutions of string theory, of the equations, all the possible values of coupling constants, all the possible values of the cosmological constant. And it's a huge, huge number, huge landscape. How we find a way around in it, even if we ignored the question of supersymmetry, even if we ignored that particular issue, is just too many to sort through. What we do about it, I don't know. We've really reached some very, very difficult things in physics and the physics of fundamental interactions and so forth. Experiments have gotten progressively harder. If you go back to the early parts of the 20th century, how long did it take to do a quantum mechanics experiment? A year, something like that, maybe even faster. Now an experiment can easily take a whole scientific lifetime. You have to build a bigger accelerator, you have to build bigger detectors, you have to get the money to do it, and so forth and so on. So experiments from the beginning to the end can be 40 years or more. Entire scientific lifetimes. And so we've run into the problem of the difficulty of experiment. We've also come, if this picture of string theory that has this wildly proliferating landscape of possibilities, if that's correct, then we've run into the obstacle of just too many things to sort. So things are hard. For that reason, many of my colleagues, myself included, said, let's put that on the back burner. Let's simply focus on the consistency of quantum mechanics and gravity. We know gravity exists. There's no question about that. And we have to be able to put it into our quantum theories. We have to be able to make it mesh with our quantum theories. And so most of the work that people like myself, people that I interact with on a daily basis, is about the connection between quantum mechanics and gravity. And theoretical constructions, theoretical models that contain both gravity and quantum mechanics. If they contain gravity, they will contain black holes. Hopefully, we'll be able to answer some of the paradoxes about black holes. But obviously, that's not completely satisfactory. We do want to have a theory which describes the real world of electrons, photons, protons, neutrons. And we're far from that. I think we're very far from it.
So Is there a reason to believe that with any of the possible solutions to the string theory landscape that there should be an associated universe to it? So I'll give you an example.
Oh, yeah.
With Einstein's equations, there are a variety of solutions. You can even have a neutron star with a hollow center, technically. It's not like we think there must be a universe that corresponds to every solution of Einstein's equations.
If the universe is big enough, maybe so. Maybe if the universe is really big enough, then no matter how unlikely something is, it will occur somewhere. If the probability of something is 10 to the minus 100, but the universe is big enough to have 10 to the 200 regions of space, then you have more than enough to somewhere find your hollow neutron star.
You understand the point that just because there's the laws of physics that allow for something, it doesn't necessarily mean that the existence has to follow that possibility.
I qualify my statement. If the universe is big enough, if it's big enough and it has, if its equations, first of all, a question, do its equations allow variety to exist? Do the equations allow a region over here and a region over here to be different from each other? Which the equations of cosmology, inflation, eternal inflation do allow, that the universe can have patches with different behaviors. And if the universe is big enough, then just on ordinary probability grounds, some place will have whatever it is you're looking for. Now, you're not used to thinking of things which are that big, so big that essentially anything can happen somewhere. You're not used to that. But that's what it would take to make this landscape theory and all that kind of stuff make sense. The universe just has to be very big. To our knowledge, the universe is exponentially expanding. It may have been exponentially expanding way, way into the past. If it was exponentially expanding deep into the past, it will be exponentially big. It was exponentially big. It means very, very much bigger than the region we can see. We're used to thinking of the universe as being about 20 billion light years big. But that's just the part we can see. That's the part that we can see without running into a horizon. If the universe is old enough and exponentially expanded for a long enough time in the past, it could be vastly, vastly bigger than that.
Well, what I mean is that Einstein's field equations allow for the Schwarzschild solution, for instance, so static black hole. That static black hole is eternal, it's isolated, it doesn't decay, it doesn't even form. It's always been there and it will always be there. So that can't be a solution of the universe, no matter how large the universe is spatially. In other words, GR is about the whole universe itself, and that any particular
solution,
you could say it's true in an isolated case, but if you take a solution seriously, it's about all of space-time.
Yes, Einstein's equations by themselves would say that a black hole will just sit there forever and ever in otherwise empty space. Hawking told us, no, yes, Einstein's equations are wrong about that. The black hole will evaporate. But I'm not sure that's relevant to our discussion here. Einstein's equations predict that a black hole is eternal. Quantum mechanics predicts that a black hole would evaporate. Which one is right? Almost everybody I know thinks that the quantum mechanics answer is right. But that's beside the point. We're not talking about black holes here. We're talking about what a physicist would call vacuum solutions.
Mm-hmm.
Vacuum solutions mean essentially empty space. When I say there's lots of solutions, I don't mean that the solutions describing black holes. I mean that there are solutions describing empty space. And what are those solutions about? They're not about the presence of black holes. They're about the values of the coupling constants, about the values of the masses, about the spectrum of elementary particles. So each solution has a different collection of elementary particles. Some may have electrons, which are 2,000 times lighter than the proton. Somewhere else in the space of solutions, you might have electrons which are 2,000 times heavier than the proton and neutron. That doesn't describe our world, but nevertheless, there may be many, many solutions like that. Some of the solutions may have large cosmological constants and not coexist with what we know. And some small fraction of them may have very, very small cosmological constants. We're not talking about the presence of black holes. We're talking about what empty space is like, what the rules of quantum field theory will look like. And as I said, there's a huge variety of those things. Now, your question is a good one now. Do we have any reason to believe that these different solutions will materialize and manifest themselves in our large universe? Is the universe big enough so that statistically all of these different properties will exist someplace in some region of space? Inflation is a theory which tells us that the universe is maybe exponentially, and maybe even exponential, maybe even exponential, times bigger than the region we can see. So we have no idea what's out there beyond the region we can see. It could be a bit of this, someplace, that, someplace else. And that's what the equations tell us. The equations tell us that if you wait long enough, and the universe gets sufficiently big, it will be filled like a patchwork quilt with regions of different properties, some with small cosmological constants, some with big cosmological constant. And, there'll just be a lot of stuff out there.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.